Hello everyone. Today is a very special day for me because I will be introducing you to the Odyssey test. It's a project that I've been working on together with my company for the last 2 years. And it's in fact the outcome of my whole life, I would say, not just the work over the last 2 years, but in fact, everything was leading me to this project, I think, since the very, very beginning. And I'm very excited about it. I would like to tell you a bit about the rationale and the methodology today, and about the purpose of this tool that we built. And if you have any questions, of course, please drop the questions below or connect with me on LinkedIn. I'll be happy to answer all your questions. The tool is called the Ontology of Value, and we put a shortcut of the Odyssey on it. The job market today is complicated. As I've already mentioned in my recent book, What is Out There for Me, The Landscape of Post-PhD Career Tracks, the job market is a very complex landscape. And in this landscape, to briefly put, we have all kinds of working environments, and these working environments can either give you more safety, more stability in the workplace and in your career, or they can give you more personal freedom to choose your own projects and to choose people to work with, but usually at the cost of lower level of stability in your daily life. And it's up to you what you eventually choose, of course. But I will, as we will be speaking today, it also depends on your natural capabilities and personality, where you fit best in this landscape. So, briefly, we have jobs in public sector, we have jobs in private companies, from corporations and large companies all the way to startups, and we have academic jobs, and actually more and more people today enter academia at a later stage in their careers, because a lot of people also dreamt about PhD for the whole youth, and they only do it when they feel like they're done with everything else, all the other duties in their lives. So then they enter the research path at some point in their lives. So it's not an ivory tower anymore. Academia also mingled with industry. Now we have joint projects between universities and private companies. So academia actually opened its gates to everyone right now. And lastly, we have entrepreneurship and freelancing. These are paths of adventure for people who don't really feel like they need a boss. They highly value freedom, but at the cost of certain degree of uncertainty, of course. And the question is, how to self-navigate in such conditions? And also, why so many hardworking and talented people today get stuck with their careers? We all know those people. We all know people who had best grades at school, who had incredible talent when they were teenagers. Yet today they have boring jobs. They are not necessarily entirely happy with their professional lives. And somehow, despite their talent, despite their hard work, they could not navigate themselves well enough to now have the careers of their dreams. And of course, how not to become such a person, how not to end up in a dark corner in the job market. So first of all, one misconception that job hunters often make is that when they are looking for jobs, they look at their CV first and they ask themselves, okay, what are my skills? What is my skill set? What can I do? What types of projects am I suited for? What type of profession, what type of positions? And they try to figure what is their fit in terms of expertise and skills with the positions they're applying for. Nothing wrong with that, of course, but this is not the only dimension that you should be looking at, because there is also this other dimension that is all about your personality, your motivation, your mentality, your working style. And these are your personal traits that are equally important as your skills. Yet, we often overlook those dimensions when we are looking for jobs or looking for careers. And this is what I would like to focus on today. And specifically, I would like to focus on the motivation part. So to briefly mention, I notice this problem often, that we don't really understand each other's motivations as professionals often, since we have a very different motivation structure. Each one of us is motivated by different factors and situations internally. And some examples, for instance, many people have this detrimental stereotype of a secretary as not very ambitious person who is more of an appeaser and not really interested in hard work, and just interested in cozy position and appeasing everyone around. And that's of course a detrimental stereotype, as secretaries can be extremely ambitious, and usually they are. It's just that their ambition is more about how to build infrastructure for other people around them rather than how to get promoted by themselves. Another example, influencer, a person who has following on social media, who is content creator, who appears here and there to show up and present their content or just share stories from their life. Well, those people usually, once they get to certain level of recognition, usually it's for a reason. Usually it means they have content and they have certain motivation, and usually they have some sense of mission. And in this business, it's really hard to get through this initial stages and keep on going for years and years before you're eventually successful if you don't have any message to convey. And most people who are active in social media, they have such a message. So this is again a detrimental stereotype that many people have about influencers. Another example, investors, people who live off from investing funds into all kinds of assets, but also other companies, young people, startups. They are often taken as greedy, as empty, as money oriented, but for them most often money is just a means of getting to what they really want, which is stability and freedom to do the projects they like to do. And that's usually the real motivation, and money is just a means to get there. And so that's again how people just have misconceptions of each other. So that's why it's really important to talk about motivation and try to understand each other. And let's talk a little bit about what lies at the roots of human motivation. And of course, it would be hard to talk about the subject without getting back to the roots of the modern school of psychology and talking a little bit about the popular theories that relate to human motivation. So what are these theories? Well, all of us probably already heard of Sigmund Freud's work. Sigmund Freud was an Austrian psychiatrist living in the first half of the 20th century and working in the first half of the 20th century. And he developed this concept of the unconscious. And for him, the roots of human motivation lie in this desire to feed the unconscious instincts like ego and superego. And then we had Carl Gustav Jung, his student, who developed quite a different theory, his own theory of human motivation. And according to Carl Gustav Jung, the roots of human motivation lie in trying to find a balance between the outer world and the world in our minds. And lastly, I'd like to talk a little bit about Alfred Adler. He's actually less known than the other two. He was also working with Sigmund Freud. Sigmund Freud treated him as a friend and as equal. And Adler also originally started from sharing his mentors and friends' concept of the unconscious, but he also differentiated later, and he turned into developing his own theory of human motivation. And according to him, we all have a desire to prove our value to ourselves and to the rest of the world and build value. And this is, in his eyes, what lies at the roots of human motivation. And we all have this upward drive for perfection. That was his belief. And I like to stay a bit longer by the spread theory because I have to say it speaks to me. Ever since I first read about it many, many, many years ago as a student of psychology at the University of Warsaw, it spoke to me straight away. And I started digging deeper into this theory. So let's talk about value. How can we create value and what value actually is? So value is something quite intangible. It's a concept of creating something that's has value, right? So it's really hard to describe what value actually is. It's something that is beneficial. It's beneficial to another person. It's beneficial to a legal person, like a company, or maybe it's beneficial to a whole society. And in our society, value circulates. So first we have businesses that basically combine value produced by their own employees and then distribute what they produce. They basically process this value, right? Produce a product or a service and distribute this product or service to their clients. And of course get funds for it because they have to have this operation funds to run. And businesses as such are value sources. They basically pull value from their own employees to produce even more value for their clients. That's the whole concept of a business. Then we have freelancers who, well, don't have employees, but in principle it works the same. They produce value for the clients, they get funds back. Then we have public institutions, and public institutions pull value from their own employees and then distribute this value to the society. And since they are non-profit, then they have, of course, a deficit of funds because of this. But then we have the government, and the government basically pulls funds from the sources of value that are for profit, such as businesses and individuals who earn considerable money, and distribute them back to public institutions to compensate for this deficit, of course, as well as they supply under like the groups that are at disadvantage, such as disabled, retirees, and unemployed. So basically the government is like a pump that pumps funds from the sources of value who are profit to the sources of value who are non-profit. All right, so that's pretty much how it works. And what is really important here is that the value always comes first. The money only comes second. So the value is the real currency that circulates in the job market, and the money only follows the value. And I have to stress it here because many job hunters make this misconception and make this mistake that they fully focus on looking for paycheck, like looking at the numbers, and they are thinking, where can I get the most, the highest paycheck? Where can I get the most money for what I do? But perhaps sometimes it's good to ask yourself, where can I produce the most value? Because that really is something that triggers the money. So sooner or later, if you position yourself in the job market in a way that you produce the most value, then the money will come. It might come with delay, but it is forgiven. It is for certain. Money will come because the money reflects the value you produce in one way or another. So how to discover your natural way of building value? Since we all have our individual ways, so how to tell what is your natural way of building value that is that is a type of role that you should play to or you should choose to make sure that depending on your own personality, working style, mentality, values, that you will produce the most value for other people, for businesses, for society. So now we will talk a little bit about the ways of measuring your natural abilities. And if you have that question, what can I do to produce value? Which tools can you use to make this question easier for yourself? So are there any self-help tools that you can use today to help yourself answer this question? So what are the current options? Well, You can take some general personality tests, such as 15 personalities is actually based on the Myers-Briggs model, which is based on Carl Gustav Jung's model of human motivation. You can take the classic Big Five model. And there are, of course, thousands of other models. These are just the most popular ones. And these, what these tests are doing, they basically, you will be asked a range of questions about your everyday behaviors and everyday decisions. And they will try to decompose your personality into independent dimensions. In 16 personalities, it's four dimensions. In Big Five, it's five factors or five dimensions. And then they will grade you on each scale. Then we have strength finders or talent finders, such as the famous Gallup strength finder, which basically will tell you what are your top strengths in the workplace. And then you will get a number of tips of how to use these strengths in your career. And again, this is a self-help tool. You will be asked a range of questions, and then you will be given, you will, in this time you will be given a list of like a ranking of top scores. Lastly, we have thousands and thousands of online professional aptitude tests. I listed the two here, but there are literally thousands of them. And usually they basically ask you what your skills are, and they give you a list of professions where which you would match, such as, for instance, they ask you, can you do medical writing, or are you a strong writer? And if you say yes, then they will say, well, then you should probably be a writer. This is, of course, a simplification, but just to give you the idea, they basically ask you about your skills and ask you to grade your skills. And then they will give you some ideas for what types of professions you might consider. So these are your options, more or less, at the moment. But to me, when I was looking into this, it seemed from the very beginning that something is missing here, something more holistic, something that will tell you what is your potential as a value builder in the job market, and that will take into account not only your personality but also your working style, something that you were working on for your lifetime, and your type of professional ethics. So everything that you are as a professional today, it will take the full description of you as a professional, and given that, it will give you a ranking of, okay, in what roles and in which working environments, where in this landscape that the job market really is, where do you fit best? So, and also, where in the job market are the people who think similar as you think? Because just think about this. If you, let's say, want to become a data scientist, and then you have a choice. Shall I go to a corporation? Shall I go to a startup? Shall I start my own company? Your life will look completely differently depending on what you choose. So it's a very important decision. Like, you really have to think about, where in the job market is my tribe? Where are the people who will understand me, who will see my value, who will let me work my way, so that I can deliver my way and make my best my way? Instead of trying to fit me into some box that I might not necessarily fit. This will have a major, major influence on your level of satisfaction from work, and in the long run on your results and on your whole career. So that's actually a very important decision. So that's how it all started. That's how I came to the concept that, well, it's high time to build a tool that will help professionals to find their edge in the job market, to find the right place, the right role, the right working environment. So, but how to create a new model in psychometry? It's not easy. It's not such a simple thing to do, because if it was simple, it would already have been done a long time ago. So, just as an example, how is it normally done? Well, there are many ways to approach this kind of problem. So, creating new models, like there are many different strategies that are being used in popular psychometric tools. For instance, the Myers-Briggs type indicator, so the popular 16 personalities test, it was created by a mother and daughter, Catherine Cook Briggs, and Isabel Briggs Myers. And it was based on the literature on the work by Carl Gustav Jung. And they did field research. They were researching their environment, their friends, their acquaintances. And they started developing gradually before the test actually reached the final form where it could be put to commercial use. But basically the basis was the literature and the field research. So it was not strictly a data-driven method. It was more based on literature research and the field research. As opposite to that, Big Five was created differently. It was actually not just at one go. It was developed over the years by many professionals in the field of psychometrics. And it started from just two dimensions. And then the third dimension was introduced. And then in the end, today we have five dimensions to the model. And this model is more data driven. So it was developed through factor analysis. And that means that a large number of questions was asked to a large population of respondees. And then on the outcome data, the factor analysis was performed and the components with that were explaining the highest proportion of the variance were taken into the model as these independent dimensions. But well, the fact that this model was being created for 10 or 20 years and it had to go through all these stages, that also is an indication that even psychometrics is based on very noisy data. It's a human psychometric data. There is no more noisy data than this, and that's why it's like even approaching models in this like fully scientific way and trying to analyze it using factor analysis and machine learning sometimes fails, and no one knows how many dimensions in reality human personality has. Maybe it's five. Maybe it's seven, maybe it's 15. And it was a human decision to stop with five and say, okay, we are done with this model. It could be as well 10 or 15 or any other arbitrary number. So when I was thinking about the best approach, I thought for a long time because human motivation is probably one of the hardest possible concepts to try to analyze in scientific terms and model. So first, I was thinking about factor analysis, but in the end, I decided to go more Kubrick's and Briggs-Myers way, and approach the problem similarly as they approached creating 16 personalities. So it was more through the analyzing the work of the source material from Alfred Adler and a lot of field research, and then once the categories were created, so that's the basis, that's the pillars of the model, the categories, the dimensions that we are working on. Then the rest was done like in a purely scientific way, so fitting the model with use of psychometrics and machine learning. So that part I could actually do semi-automatically using classic methods that I was also using my PhD in brain research as well. So these are classic techniques from data science and machine learning. How many different ways can we possibly make a contribution, or in other words, how many different types of motivation are there? As that's the question here. So according to the results we've got, well, at least eight. And I'd like to briefly introduce you the silhouettes of these profiles. Of course, the more detail you will find in the test I'm now talking about, and in a booklet to the test, it's described in every detail. But here I would like to talk about the basic content. And so now a few words about these eight main types of value builders in the job market. So first of all, we have the creator, and creator is a person who is a visionary, who is a creative person, an artist, not necessarily working in arts. Creators are everywhere, even on stock exchange or in politics. So it just basically means someone who has this inner desire to produce new content and produce concepts. And as for the strengths and weaknesses of creators, well, they creators think big. That's the obvious strength. And they are creative, and they are also very dedicated. They have high perseverance. They can go on for years and years before they finally succeed. So they have that gut strength in their gut to be successful. But on the other hand, well, they rarely compromise on their ideas. Idea, for them, idea is even more important than people. Idea is everything. And they are often risk takers. They could risk way, way too much for their ideas. And sometimes it ends up with broken careers as well. Then we have problem solvers. And the problem solver who is basically driven by solving problems for others. It can be a programmer, it can be a carpenter, it could be problem solvers are everywhere. Problem solvers are in every company, especially in R&D department, but also in academia, also in every other environment, you will find problem solvers. Well, they have very deep knowledge about one particular subject, and they are adaptable. They can work with all kinds of bosses. They are usually really easygoing and they are rational. They have rational expectations from life, rational expectations from work, and they are pleasant to work with. But weaknesses are that, well, they are not born managers. So if they are put in the role of a manager, they sometimes struggle. And also they sometimes lack these self-promotion skills that would allow them to thrive in the job market. And they are vulnerable since they are so highly specialized. Sometimes, because there are of course transferable skills such as programming that are useful everywhere. But some of the skills that problem solvers have might be too specific sometimes. So there is always a danger of just that your knowledge will get outdated in the job market. Okay, then we have linchpins. And linchpin is someone who is connecting people. Linchpin is basically this middle part of the wheel, that pivotal part, and is also a description of someone who is center of their environment and who is heart and soul of the party and who can connect people, negotiate, create communities, etc. Well, of course, linchpins are very strong at communication, and they also have a good command of chaos, which is very useful in today's world. And they understand capitalism. They understand that there is no free lunch, that to get something from someone, you have to give something first. They have a very good understanding of this social exchange. But also they often come across as too optimistic about their projects. That's why we have so many hustlers, right? That hustle because they are just optimistic about what they do. They don't really see the caveats of the projects they hustle about. So that's also sometimes it's a matter of optimism and not of bad intentions. And of course, they have this information overload. They have to process a lot of information every day, and that's extremely exhausting. And also they only communicate and spread other people's ideas. And sometimes they have this sense of void that they kind of always work on accelerating other people's projects. They don't have their own legacy. Then we have a manager. And managers are individuals who basically are driven by leading functional teams and making people speak to each other and work together. And well, managers are actually very good at managing both at work and at home. And well organized and understand people, but they have a lot of responsibility on their shoulders, and they have high expectations both toward other people and themselves. Next, we have achievers, and achievers are people who are kind of born to be role models. They want to be role models for others, and examples are of course competitive athletes. But also, you know, content creators are often achievers, and but also you can meet them everywhere. You can meet them in business as well, in every organization actually. And they have a message. They have a vision. They want to become a role model to convey specific message. So they clearly have a vision and a mission in their life, and they are resistant to stress. They are perseverant. They have high discipline, And but as for weaknesses, they also, well, it's a really risky path. They sometimes lack plan B. They have to take public responsibility for what they do. And the work never really ends because there's always someone to chase after. So yeah, this is the work that never ends. And then we have missionaries. And missionaries, an individual whose biggest drive is to help people directly. So these are, of course, teachers, but also many other professions across the board. And as for strengths, missionaries, first of all, they are like driven, motivated, independent, empathic, and they care about the person whom they help. They don't care that much about their bosses or the rest of their environment. They are focused on building bonds with their clients, their patients, so people whom they directly help. And that's also often why many freelancers are actually have mindset like this. But as for weaknesses, sometimes missionaries lack this self-navigation skills, and sometimes they don't really understand capitalism all that well. Okay, the next we have contributors. And contributor is someone who prefers to build an infrastructure for others. And we have contributors pretty much in every organization. And they are good team players. They are they have negotiation and mediation skills, of course. They are very loyal. So these are very like demanded, desired traits in the job market. As for weaknesses, well, they lack salesmanship skills often. And they seek for safety. Sometimes it's not possible. Today, in today's world, it's hard to find safety, honestly speaking. And they can be dependent on their team, which is also a downside. And investors aim to achieve full financial independence, and they prefer to do projects out of will, not out of need, and they treat money as a means to achieve that goal. And well, they are good decision makers. They are self-sufficient and they are very rational. Even when they risk, they make calculated risks. So at the end of the day, it's rational choices. But well, the weaknesses are that, well, it takes a long time to develop a career. It's a very risky path, and they are individualist, which is sometimes not the best trait to have today, because today everything is based, like work in most organizations is based on projects that are team projects. So if you're an individualist, well, then you will have, well, there is a limited number of professions where you can thrive. So do we have just one profile, or can we contribute in any more than one way? Yes, of course we can. And in most professions and in most working environments, the desired profile for an employee is a combination of a few of these different profiles. So these represent the roles that you take in the working environment, but depending on the situation, you might take different roles. You might be, let's say, if you're working, let's say, in academia, you are a researcher at the university, then you will have to be a little bit of a creator to create new concepts. Then you will have to be a problem solver to design experiments to prove the concepts or to carry out research. And then you also have to be a manager to manage younger students and self-manage your career as well. You have to be a missionary to again teach students, and you have to be a bit of a contributor, because today researchers are also involved in creating research infrastructure. So you will be expected to be active, to be a member of some professional associations, and to also do something on behalf of open science once in a while. This is like quite a standard career point today to be involved. And you, of course, also have to talk about your work with other researchers, present at the conferences. So you also have to work as a linchpin sometimes. So you will have to swap between many different roles. And in most professions, in most work environments, this is true that you need more than one role, and you need to effectively juggle between a few. And so, but is this all you need to succeed in the job market? If you know your profile, right? Well, the answer is not necessarily, because you also need to know your tribe. As mentioned before, the environment that you that you're going to join is equally important as knowing what is your preferred role. So so it's best to know both. It's best to know what type of value builder you are, or in which roles you actually are most efficient, but you also should know where in the job market are people who think like you. So according to this model that we've built, there are at least 8 different working environments that you could be considering, and they have different culture. Of course, every company and every organization has their own microclimate and microculture, but here I'll be talking more in general about these 8. So just very briefly, since I wrote the whole book about it, so it will be hard to review the whole book in just a few minutes, but let me just give you a few just a few statements about each one of them. So firstly, we have public institutions and non-governmental organizations, and the general structure is close to corporations, so the departments are segregated into teams, and the work is project-based. You will have a lot of meetings there, but usually it's very stable. You can work there for a lifetime, well, it's highly procedural, but it's really safe as a working environment. Then we have corporations, and well, the structure of a corporation is very complex, and multiple level of management. And corporation has to have very tight, strong management, because it's like a backbone that puts the company together and makes it alive. So it's like a huge organism, and management puts it in form, in shape. And daily life is also full of meetings, and also you have goals and financial targets for every year to fulfill. But you also have a lot of opportunities. The company will invest in you, will invest in courses, in travels, in learning opportunities. Corporations are willing to invest a lot in their employees. But also you have to follow corporate procedures, and the corporation will get you obsessed. They will, there are a lot of manipulative strategies that corporations use to make you really struggle to be that employee of the month. So you have to be prepared that in a corporation, you have to be assertive to really keep your soul, you know, away. Don't get your soul stolen by the corporation. So this is, I know that it's a stereotypical thing I'm saying, but from experience, this is what often happens, that you have to really mind that you are not your company is not you, and just protect your free time. Okay, and consultancy companies we have next, and these differ a bit from corporations, because in consultancy companies you have one employer and multiple clients, and consultancy companies are all project-based. So the client delegates a project to a company, and the company executes this project, usually in a team, either on the side of the company or the side of the client. Usually the corporations, like the large consultancy companies, like McKinsey or Boston Consulting Group, they usually carry out projects on their side, and small companies usually send their consultants to the client side. That's like rule of thumb. And well, you can learn a lot about industry in this way, because you will have projects from different clients. So if you're new in an industry, this is usually a good starting point to gain a lot of industry experience in a short time. It can be exhausting, though. It can be very intensive. So you have to be prepared that for a year or two, you might be very busy in such a place. Then we have small to middle-sized enterprises. And well, these are small companies that have less than 250 employees, and the daily life is usually has more stable dynamics than corporations. It's more peaceful, it's more quiet, and the atmosphere is more like a family atmosphere. You can feel more like important in a team, because it's usually a small team. But of course, there are also downsides. So there are some more limited promotion opportunities, and you are more dependent on your boss and close colleagues. And of course, there's a probability that the company will get acquired as well. Then we have startups. And well, the startups usually have very flat structure. It's more, again, like family-like, and usually quite informal startup atmosphere, famous, and usually flexible working hours as well. Because at the end of the day, what matters in a startup is your efficiency. It doesn't matter how many hours you work. And it's a real teamwork. People who work in startups usually enjoy it as a place where they can really feel like they work in a team. And well, what is not very good is that, again, you depend on your teammates to a high extent. And of course, you can flop together with a company. It's still early stage, so the company can fail. If the company fails, you fail too, in a way. And then we have academia. And in academia, well, we have a modular structure where in every department, labs have their own budget. And so when you work there, you're kind of an employee of your lab, not necessarily of the whole department. And you that makes you dependent on your direct boss. And in academia, well, usually you juggle multiple projects. The management is rather weak, rather non-involved. And that creates opportunities or problems depending on how independent you are. But you get paid for learning and you could travel to nice places, work with friends, work on interesting topics. So if you work out your career skillfully, then you can have a very nice lifestyle doing what you really like doing. So this is clearly an opportunity. And well, but there's a very strong luck factor here. And in academia, there are still high depression levels among academics. There is a lot of rat race and contracts are short. So it's in general stressful lifestyle. Then we have freelancing, which means that you work on your own, you work for yourself basically. And your daily life looks as you design it. It's your decision how it looks. Well, so there is a high degree of freedom. And you can also, if you are good at what you're doing and you're consequent, you can get to a high salary range, which is great. But you also can experience a lot of solitude on the other hand. And yeah, and you need to also, yeah, you have to be your own salesman, salesperson. And you will need to price your work. You will need to hustle around for clients, at least in the beginnings. And so these are like barriers to entry that make it hard for a lot of people. And lastly, we have entrepreneurship, and entrepreneurship is basically running between your investors, clients, and employees. It's not as much freedom, especially in the beginning, as you might think. And a lot of meetings, a lot of salesmanship, troubleshooting problems all day. This is how daily life looks. But the opportunity is to become financially free. That's the reward. And you can also choose whom you work with, because it's your decision and only your decision, and you only do important things. You don't do unimportant tasks at all in a startup. Well, but the working hours are of course very long, and there is also a lack factor. There's a lot of competition, so there is a danger you'll fail as well. All right. So well, and one thing I wanted to say is that, as you can see, in any one of these environments, there are certain things that you have to accept. So there is no El Dorado. There is not one place that where everyone is happy, everyone makes good bucks. In every one of these environments, there are certain advantages and disadvantages. So which one of these environments you fit best depends on your natural capabilities. And in some of them, you might feel quite comfortably, and it will all go easy for you. And in some of them, you would feel this internal blockade that you're not very appreciated and evaluated high enough for what you do, and that you have tension straight away. So that's why it's so important to think about this cultural differences before you make a choice. But what does it mean to fit somewhere? Because when we talk about tribes or working environments, we talk about fitting or not fitting there. Well, when we talk about fit, it's actually good to refer back to the most classic distribution ever, the Gaussian distribution, that basically means that every trait is distributed normally in a large population, and that basically means that, well, if you want to talk about, am I fit, am I a good fit to a certain working environment, then it's often good to compare compare with the general population, right? So there are certain traits and certain attitudes that are preferred in that in that area, in that environment, and like there is a population of white collar professionals that represent or don't represent those traits, and the question is, where do I fall in this population? Am I on the right side of the Gaussian tail or on the left side? Am I like fitting better or am I fitting less good than most people, right? Because the numbers, like absolute numbers, won't tell you much. I think what is really important is to compare with a general population. So what this test that we built gives you, in fact, are two rankings, and then they both give you percentiles. And a percentile means a percentage of individuals, white collar professionals from our studies, that score lower than you. That means that, for instance, in this example, if you have a percentile of 53.73 for an investor, that means that you fit the profile of an investor better than 53.73% of all professionals. Or when you have a result for entrepreneurship that is at the level of 15.51, that means your score is only better than 15%, 0.51, 15.51% than the general population, etc. And it's really important to have this full ranking, because this is the overview of your potential, where your potential really is and to what extent. So are you better than the average, or are you maybe quite low in the population? And I think this is much more telling than just raw absolute numbers, and can tell you a lot about the possible directions that where you might excel versus possible directions where you might perish in the job market. Yeah, and now I would like to talk a little bit more about the methodology behind the test that we've just created. First of all, what is the aptitude? According to Wikipedia, an aptitude is a component of a competence to do a certain kind of work at a certain level. An outstanding aptitude can be considered talent. So aptitude tests, actually, we've mentioned some of them before, and examples of famous aptitude tests would be, for instance, Raven's Progressive Matrix Test and Gallup Strength Finder, and also 16 personalities tests. So all these tests that we all know that take some quantitative measures of our cognitive abilities or personality traits. And these were done in different ways. So Raven's Progressive Matrix Test is a cultural neutral logic puzzle. And the Gallup Strength Finder is a set of 177 Likert scale questions. And 16 personalities is 60 Likert scale questions. So Likert scale means that you evaluate yourself and evaluate certain sentence on the scale, let's say from 1 to 5 or from 1 to 7. And we compose the questions in the following way. So as mentioned before, Likert scale is basically the most as most popular scale. It contains sentences, and you are asked to evaluate yourself on the scale. But in this case, we decided to introduce some multiple choice questions instead. Because the reason was very simple, because if you have a Likert scale, then participants will lose attention with time. So as soon as they start losing attention, then they start clicking the middle option, right? Because middle option means I don't know or neutral. And so you only get a good estimation for the first few questions, and then the later, like the farther it goes, the worse the estimation is. Versus if you have a multiple choice question, you cannot skip a question in a lazy way, in any way. You have to choose one option out of four, and you're pushed to think. You cannot really skip a question. So you are pushed to think until the very, very last question, and this was exactly the motivation. And also what the motivation was was to create an experience. So give participants a chance to contrast and confront certain opinions or certain ways of thinking and certain motivations, and give them a chance to really spend this time thinking about themselves, about their professional past, about their preferences, about what is really important in life for them. And it's meant to be something more than just sitting in front of a computer and basically choosing options for an hour or two. It's supposed to be experience of thinking about yourself and what is really important for you. So it's supposed to be something pleasant, something also challenging a bit. So some of these questions are difficult. They're hard to answer for a reason. The reason is to challenge you and to make you think really hard about your career so far. And just an example of such a question, and this is the question that people dwell on in these tests for a long time often. And this is a question: if you could give yourself one warning at the beginning of your career, what would it be? So this is just an example to show you that the questions are like, they push you to think. And most of the questions in the set are like this. They're like, you cannot really skip them in a lazy way. You have to give it a thought. And in our test, we actually took into account four types of variables. First of all, we took into account the working style, and then the type of mind and resilience to stress. By type of mind, I mean, for instance, whether or not you are a specialist or a generalist, or what type of problems you particularly like to solve. And third type of variable was your relations with people, with your bosses, with authorities, with your peers at work, and in general, all kinds of people with whom you have professional relations. And lastly, your values and beliefs as well. And the research pipeline was like classic. First, we did some classic cleaning of the data according to the standard psychometric practices. So we were looking at correlations between different questions, and we were just removing the redundant ones or the ones that were not very informative, because most participants were giving the same response. So there was no variance in the question. So first we started with a set of 140, and then after the first round of the study, we reduced it to 128, combined into four groups. And then in the second batch, another set of participants was filling in and then of course we built the classifier first. So we did the data science on this data. We built a linear classifier to build the whole model, of course. And then with this model, we validated this model on the second group of participants, and then we sent them results. We asked them, do you agree with these results? Do they well describe you? And we actually got very positive responses. That's also why I was confident to release this test, because from the testing group, from the validation group, I knew that that the model actually fits the purpose and meets the purpose and hits the marks. So I was very happy hearing the reactions, and listening to the participants from validation group. And then so that was the design. So we did it in two batches, and then after the whole process came to the end, we had a functional model that we then incorporated into backend of our website to be able to provide with automated tool where the participant can just answer the full set of questions and get the results straight onto their screen. And lastly, I'd like to say a few words about the name of the test, the Odyssey, because it was not really straightforward. It was quite a challenge to name this test. And this will be, these few words will be more of a business development than science. So now I was talking about psychology, I was talking about human motivation, I was talking also about how to build a new psychometric test. So I was talking about more like factual things. And now I would like to say a little bit about business development part. So as a fresh business developer, why it was so challenging for me to come up with a good name for this test. And for a few reasons, actually, because A good name for a task has to have many different features, in fact. So it has to be memorable. It has to be something that once you hear it, you kind of, it rings a bell, or it's so characteristic that you can easily remember. It also has to have some positive association. So you have to know what types of values you want to be associated with, or you want to convey, of what type of message. And in my mind, like, professional career is a lifelong journey, and you have to have a good self-navigation system in this journey. So for me, Odyssey actually hits the mark here, and has that positive association that I was looking for. And it also conveys the right values. It's a synonym of a struggle and courage and perseverance, and also carries a lot of it carries a positive vibrations, I would say. And it's also, like, again, from business standpoint, it had to be trademarkable. It had to be something that we can protect, and also it had to be something that we can even register as a domain, because it's important to be visible online as well, to be able to, for people to find you. If someone hears Odyssey, they should be able, while typing in Google, they should be able to find you. And we were struggling with this a lot, because every name that contained, like, the usual suspects, such as Career Compass or Career GPS or anything related to careers straight, like, directly, was already taken, and all these domains were already taken. So I was thinking to myself, if I name this tool Career Compass, let's say, it will be very accurate, because it is a career compass. In fact, it shows you the direction in the job market, but there are already 50 other projects that are all named Career Compass. So if someone hears about the test, wants to take it, they couldn't find it online. So this was actually a challenge to come up with a name that has all these features on the list. And it's not without a reason that copywriters are well paid. It's a well paid profession. And in the end, we sat down with a friend of mine, Daniel Borek, who is now a PhD candidate at the University of Ghent. But he's also a hobbyist copywriter, and we made a mind map. We basically listed on one chart, we listed all the ideas we had and all the associations we had and all kind of values and concepts that we would like to incorporate. And we were thinking, okay, what would be that name or a concept that would embrace as many of those as possible? And in the end, we came up with Odyssey. And Odyssey not only represents the journey, but also, according to the Greek mythology, it also had a good ending, which I guess what the ancient Greeks understood by a public massacre. Anyways, that's how we came up with the name. And what's the future of this project? Well, first of all, I believe in the gradual improvement. I believe that this is just the beginning. We have a working model, which there is the whole booklet that comes with it, the whole book that explains the model, explains the categories, lists a lot of career advice based on the results. And we kind of, it's a part of the infrastructure, it's a part of the test. But I'm, of course, going to gradually improve this booklet, and it will become thicker and thicker every time. So I'm planning to keep on improving, and I think every year we'll have another version of this test that is adjusted to the current job market, because I think it's very important to keep it actual. So definitely there will be gradual improvement. And what I especially like about this book, this is quite a famous book, What Color Is Your Parachute? It's a book about career development by Richard Bowles. I liked the fact that it was re-edited and republished already for 40 years. Every year, it's like the new edition is coming, which basically makes, you know, this makes you confident that once you get this book, the book is actual. It's updated information. And I think this is a good ambition to have here, so that once a participant takes the test, they can be confident that they will get results that well describe the conditions in the market today. So I will keep vigilant about it and keep on improving to make sure that every point in time this test is factual and give you the best estimation of your potential in today's job market. And lastly, I'd like to make a few acknowledgements. So Roger made this wonderful graphic design that you can see on the website, and he's super talented in visual arts as well. So cordial thanks to him. And Aaron built the whole backend for this test, and he built the infrastructure. If you take the test, you might enjoy this easy, user-friendly infrastructure. His beard, it works great. I have only best things to say about working with him. It was great, and he did a great job. And Lucas built the front end, so the website you see is his artwork and his job. So he's also done great, and altogether I'd like to say cordial thanks to them. And of course I would also like to thank around 600 other contributors that either contributed to the content or took part in the study, and as such were the participants and helped me to build a model. And of course, thank you so much for your attention. Thank you for getting to the end of this explanation, and good luck with your career. I'd like to cordially invite you to take a look at the test and tell me if you liked it, please. I'm curious about your opinions, about your impressions, and of course visit our website as well. We have a newsletter as well, so I can encourage you cordially to subscribe for our newsletter. Good luck with your career. And of course, if you would like to get more of career related content, then please subscribe to the channel, and I'm open to all your questions. Please post below or poke me on LinkedIn, and till next time, have a good day.